Good morning, and I would like to welcome everyone to this, the fifth meeting of the Standards, Procedures and Public Appointments Committee in 2022. I would remind virtual members to place an R in the chat function on BlueJeans if they would like to come in on any of the issues. Our first agenda item today is for the committee to agree to take agenda item 4 in private, which is an item for the committee to discuss the evidence that we will be hearing in agenda item 3. Do we agree to take that in private?
Agreed.
Thank you. Our second agenda item is for the committee to agree whether its consideration of its approach to a review of the code of conduct should also be taken in private and at future meetings. Do the members agree to take that in private as well?
Agreed.
I'm grateful. Item 3 is for the committee to hear evidence from the Acting Commissioner for Ethical Standards in Public Life in Scotland. And I would like to welcome Ian Bruce again this morning to the committee, who is the Acting Commissioner. And we will move, if that's all right with you, Ian, straight to questions. So, as convener, I'll take the privilege of going first. So, as Acting Commissioner, you've published an annual review, which has come to this committee to be addressed. But behind that, there are a number of other matters which have been outstanding, not least of all a Section 22 report from the Auditor General, and also a report that was produced at the request, I understand, of the Commissioner from Deloitte. And so we'll look at some aspects of all of that and hopefully clarify some questions that have come up. So, since you took up your position as Acting Commissioner, what action have you and also your senior colleagues taken to address the concerns about the effectiveness of the office's statutory functions, which were revealed by your auditor and also raised by the Auditor General?
Good morning, convener and members, and thank you for the opportunity to talk about the work of the office today. Quite a lot of ground to cover, I have to say, in relation to that question. Perhaps I might start with leadership and governance. I think it's fair to say we've found ourselves in quite a difficult place, a challenging place. In March last year, just prior to my appointment, I've been in post since April of last year. So we didn't need to wait for Deloitte to make a series of recommendations. I might clarify, so Deloitte are our external auditors and they are appointed by Audit Scotland, and it was their decision to undertake a wider scope review of our office for a range of reasons. We certainly did have issues in terms of our leadership and governance, and I sought to address those as soon as practicable from March onwards, and then on a more formal basis from April. I think the first thing that I did and felt that I had to do was engage very meaningfully with the staff of the organisation, and just to explain our role, our statutory role, but also what the public's expectations were of us. We weren't working to a set of formal values at that point in time. So in discussions with staff, I made it clear that I felt that we ought to operate with a set of values, including kindness and empathy towards those who came into contact with us. And we discussed the other values that we should have as an organisation, and those were then articulated in the form of a new strategic plan. So that wasn't anticipated in the usual cycle for strategic plans, but I redrafted our strategic plan and included that set of values, and it really was about meeting the public's expectations of the way in which we should operate as an office, and I ensured that all staff were on board with that in order to ensure that that would meet the expectations of our stakeholders and the public. I went on to consult on that strategic plan, so that was with really everyone who comes into contact with us in one capacity or another. The Parliament, clearly, the Scottish Government, all public bodies, all councils, COSLA, SOLAR, SOLAS, and so on. And it was a meaningful consultation, and all of the responses that we had to that plan were ultimately incorporated into the final version. So that was step one, and it allowed me to re-engage with the stakeholders because a lot of those relationships had fallen away for any number of reasons. On the back of that, I produced a biennial business plan. And so it included a whole range of actions, and ultimately it was revised to include all of the recommendations that had been made by Deloitte as part of the wider scope review that they'd conducted. So all of those were incorporated into our biennial business plan. And then staff, we hadn't had proper performance management framework in place, so staff were all reintroduced to that over the same period, and each section of the office, we have three, there's one that concerns governance, one for public appointments, one for handling complaints about conduct. So all three sections have their own individual plans that fall out of the biennial business plan, and each and every staff member understands that they make a contribution to that, and they all have individual action plans on the back of that. So everyone understands that their contribution ultimately leads to the achievement of our strategic objectives, and those objectives have been agreed basically with all of our stakeholders. I could go on, but I think that's kind of the big picture.
Yeah, I think that's very helpful, and it's right to say for the record that the Deloitte report was, although not published until with your report in October, actually covers periods up to and ending at March 2021 and the proposals that were contained therein. And that was at the point that you became acting commissioner. If I can sort of look forward, I suppose, I mean, what's your current assessment of, you know, your office's capacity now to move forward?
It's a very good question. It's probably helpful if I provide some context. I've been in post basically, not as acting commissioner, but in my prior role as public appointments manager or incarnations of that since the office of public appointments commissioner was set up in Scotland, alongside my colleague Karen Elder, who is currently the acting accountable officer. So in terms of continuity, we have plenty of continuity in relation to the public appointments functions of the office and in relation to the office's governance at sort of business manager level, for want of a better expression. Where we had issues was in relation to the complaints handling functions of the office. There are no staff in the office at the current time who were handling investigations or supporting the handling of investigations under the prior commissioner, Bill Thompson. So he had investigating officers and a team of other staff who supported that function. They have all left the organisation. So that's some context for you, and clearly that's been problematic. One of the recommendations that we had from Deloitte, but I knew it was an issue anyway, clearly, was the fact that we had to fill existing vacancies as a matter of priority. So during the tenure of the commissioner who's currently off, we had recruited a new senior investigating officer and investigating officers. He left, two of the investigating officers left. So, and it's quite a small office. There are 12 of us overall, inclusive of myself, but the headcount prior to that had actually been a bit lower. So we made a business case to the SPCB more or less immediately, just saying, look, yes, we need to fill these vacancies, and we know we don't need your blessing for that, but we really feel that we need some additional capacity as well. So we made a business case to get an additional investigating officer and a corporate services officer. One of the things that Deloitte had remarked upon was the amount of excess leave that the senior management team were carrying, and it's basically because we are all engaged, given the size of the office, in operational activities. You know, we have to do work and roll our sleeves up along with everyone else, but we needed to free up some more time. to dedicate that to the governance of the organisation. I think that was right and proper. So we also got an additional corporate services officer, and that has proved very helpful to us. Whether or not that's sufficient capacity is another question. Complaints volumes are rising quite significantly. Certainly in relation to complaints about MSPs, but also to an extent in relation to complaints about councillors and board members. And so I think, and again, Deloitte has recommended this, we do need to do further workforce planning. We are stretched at the moment. We are carrying a backlog, inevitably, because we had staff vacancies during a period when complaints continued to come in. And as I've said, those volumes have been rising. We're working our way through them as quickly as we can. But I think there's at least a distinct possibility that we are likely to require additional resource. The other thing to bear in mind is, and we are going to consult all of our stakeholders on this again, I think traditionally there's been an expectation that we should be able to get through complaints faster than we have historically. And I absolutely empathise with that. So we will consult on KPIs for the office, and clearly we'll come to the committee at that point in time and try and gauge what the public's expectation is and the expectation of stakeholders is about how quickly we should be able to get through complaints, and we will take that on board as part of our workforce planning to determine how many staff we actually require in order to get through the volume of materials that come to us. The one other thing I might mention, so I was the public appointments manager in the office. I had a public appointments officer who'd been part-time. She is acting up for me as public appointments manager. We simply could not fill her post because we could not determine for how long that, you know, person would be in post, because all of this depends on, you know, what's going to happen with the commissioner who's currently off. So we've been carrying that vacancy, and it does mean that we are short of capacity in relation to appointments as well.
Until other matters are resolved, you're unable to deal with that simply because of the situation that you're acting commissioner. In essence, someone's acting up to your previous position, which leaves an incredibly difficult vacancy to fill on the grounds that no one would know how long they were in post with it.
It's quite an arcane area of work. It's quite specialist. You know, certainly you would need HR qualities. You would need to know a lot about diversity and inclusion, because, you know, that's fundamental to boards. But also, you know, it's a regulated public appointments process. And to have a proper understanding of that does take a bit of time. But we are all relishing the challenge. You know, we are all working together as a team. And I'm more than content about the attitude of the staff. I couldn't be prouder of
that. That's very helpful. There's a few fairly specific points that I would benefit from your opinion on, which relate to requests that were made in the Deloitte report. And in the Deloitte report, there is a section where they've numbered a number of recommendations with the responses, both from yourself and others. And towards the end of that, it talks about the engagement with the SPCB and Parliament to determine the reporting route for concerns about a commissioner. I just wonder whether you'd like the opportunity to comment on that. So it says in the management's response in October that it was agreed, although all we can do is engage with the SPCB following the publication of this report, which is now being published, because you don't, as you say, you don't have locus in respect to that. So I suppose my question is, how did you feel about being asked to do something which was not your locus, or was actually, other than being able to ask about it, there's nothing much you can do about it?
I frankly have no issue with that. I recognise, I hope, and I hope all of the stakeholders that I've engaged with recognise this of me and of the office now, that we are not some standalone organisation. We are part of a bigger picture. Clearly, the Commissioner has to be independent in the exercise of her or his functions. But I think primarily the expectation there is that that independence applies to things like how we handle complaints, subject to the directions from this committee or directions from the Standards Commission for Scotland. So yes, absolutely, we need to be independent. But equally, the Parliament, the public, has a right to be reassured about the way in which the office operates. And there should be something in place, some measures in place, to address concerns as they arise about the way in which the office operates. So I have no issue with that recommendation, and I have been engaging with the SPCB throughout my tenure about what we might do. We entered most recently into more formal talks about that, because clearly, although I understood what the recommendation was, and have known for some time, the reports themselves are relatively recently published. The Section 22 report came out in December. So, you know, it was after that point in time that we began those formal discussions with the SPCB and to say, OK, you know, what can we do together? How can we work together to ensure that our governance has the sort of oversight that people would expect it to have in the future?
So, to follow that up, really, the final point, 5.3 in the audit report, was talking about there were wider governance issues that had been identified, and there was a recommendation that the SPCB, in consultation with the Commissioner and the other office holders, review whether the governance structure in place remains sufficient and appropriate. And the response from yourself was that you were happy to contribute to any consultation, because as an independent commissioner and with regard to stakeholder engagement, it is in contributing to that discussion that your role lies, rather than seeking it out or enforcing it.
Of course, absolutely. Again, I think so. Part of this issue is, and it's linked to the Paris principles, but clearly organisations such as this have to be independent. They have to be seen to be independent, because otherwise, you know, the public isn't necessarily going to have trust. And that's written into the legislation. So, you know, I'm statutorily independent of the Scottish ministers and not subject to direction or control by them. Same goes with the Parliament. But I do think that really is in relation to the functions of the office. So the regulation of appointments, how we handle complaints about MSPs. I think governance is a different matter. And I think appropriate oversight of governance is something that we would all like to see. Whether or not there are sufficient checks and balances in place at the moment for parliamentary office holders is the wider question. And I'm more than happy to contribute to discussions in that area.
That's very helpful. One of the criticisms, and it's quite a strong criticism, was that the services of the Audit Advisory Board were dispensed with. What's the situation now with regard to the Audit Advisory Board? Is it in place, coming into place? Where are we at the moment?
I've been doing a lot in tandem. I re-engaged with the Advisory Audit Board as soon as I came into post. So basically from May onwards, they were engaged in the work of the office and engaged meaningfully. So I'll give you some examples. We had to, you'll have seen the recommendations, but you know, we had to reintroduce a proper risk management policy, procedures, risk register, so they assisted us with that, and that's all in place now. We were advised that we should have an independent internal auditor on board, and we had assistance from the Advisory Audit Board with that. They also assisted us with discussions with the auditors over the wider scope review. So we are fully engaged with AAEB and have been since May, and their assistance has been excellent.
Thank you. Bob, I think you wanted to come in.
Yes, thanks, Convener. Good morning, Mr. Bruce. I was a very specific question. I get there's a degree of uncertainty because you're currently in an acting position, and then there's a member of your team currently backfilling an acting position, your previous post, and you outlined the difficulties in then being able to fill that post because of all those uncertainties. But the organisation doesn't strike me as being awash with staff, and that additional staff members would be of value for the organisation. And I get that it may have to be a temporary position, but at how many years could a temporary post be put in place for that unfilled position? And if matters resolved itself for the acting position that you and your colleague are in, if there was surplus staff, it doesn't sound to me as if it would be difficult to redeploy them to do other jobs and tasks within the organisation. So have you made a bid to the corporate body to say we could do with a three-year temporary post in this unfilled position? We appreciate it, specialist. There's training will be required, but should the other matters resolve themselves, by goodness, we can find a particularly important job for them within the wider office, given the constraints we have in our time at the moment.
So I think it would be probably helpful just to make it clear that we did advertise that post, and at the time we'd advertised it for, at that point in time, it was at least a year, but potentially more. We also spoke to the Parliament about the possibility of secondment. None of those routes were successful for us. It's quite a difficult market at the moment to get new staff on board. I mean, we've been working through a pandemic while all this has been going on as well. So we certainly tried to fill that post. We were very successful in respect of the other ones. I think the new people that we've onboarded, so, you know, we've got three new IOs and a corporate services officer, recognised something about the values that we had as an office. So in terms of recruitment, I think we've done quite well. And I understand what you're saying, but I think it is quite a specialist post, and I'm not sure it would be best use of resources for us at this precise moment in time to try and just fill that and train someone up and then try and redeploy them into some other area, because every post in the office is quite specialist. Notwithstanding that, I've said we are planning to do further workforce planning, and that's currently scheduled for March and April. And that's the point at time at which. So again, you know, we're talking about relatively short timescales. We recruited, had people inducted, the new people in October. You know, it's just that recent, and they are now all working on cases. Their probationary period ends in March. We have no issues, but it ends in March. And at that point in time, we'll do that proper workforce planning, and then we'll go to the SPCB with a proper business case. We've already... Melanie Stronach, who I mentioned earlier, who's acting up for me currently, has already prepared, you know, a really excellent forward plan for the appointments and activities of the office, and I think we've got a good handle on the resource that we'll need for that. And if there's still uncertainty, I will certainly take on board the suggestion that we might look to fill a post for, say, 3 years. And if we've got that spare capacity for appointments, I'll certainly make use of it over that period.
Convener, I just wanted to make sure there wasn't a barrier that we weren't seeing as a committee to fill that post. And I thank Mr. Bruce for clarifying that position.
Thank you, Bob. I'm now going to pass over to Tess, who has a few more questions.
Thank you. Hello, Mr. Bruce. Really good to hear that you've got business plans in place and a risk register. But when, and I realise you're in an acting position, but you've had a lot to do since March, April. Looking forwards, when do you think you'll, you know, with everything staying the same in terms of current staffing and filling that post, do you think you'll be able to reach a position of compliance, full compliance?
Are we talking about compliance with the directions from the Standards Commission?
Yes.
So the Commission confirmed to the Parliament, I think it was November last year, that I've been fully complying with the directions since I took up post. So we fully comply with the directions.
Great, okay.
Sorry, I was just getting, I'm not sure whether it's the directions from the Commission or indeed the proposals in Deloitte's audit report about.
We've made significant progress in relation to Deloitte's audit report. I did take some notes just of some of the things that we do have in place already. I should say as well, so I gave Deloitte an update in advance of their evidence session with the Public Audit Committee, so they know where we are up to January. We don't just have a biennial business plan in place, we also have a tracker, so we know what progress we are making against all the recommendations, as well as the actions that I've introduced myself, because, you know, I think there are other things we need to be getting on with. That's looked at the senior management team meeting every month, so we know exactly where we are. It's discussed with all the staff every month, so everyone knows exactly where we are. I've mentioned engagement with our AAB, the appointment of an internal auditor. We've re-established regular and meaningful senior management team meetings. The minutes are all available on our website, so, you know, it's all transparent. Everyone can see what we're up to and where we are with things. We have a stable staff contingent for the first time in a long time, other than that one unfilled vacancy. The updated risk management policy and registers in place. We updated all of our HR-related policies. I mean, staff well-being was fundamental to our recovery. So all of those were updated. Staff were consulted on them. Those have all been rolled out. We have an advanced draft of the investigations manual that was recommended. That's now a version 4. And it covers all the investigatory functions of the office. Angela Glenn, our senior investigating officer, has done an amazing job on that, as well as getting through, you know, the day-to-day work. And we'll come out to all our stakeholders to consult on that and all the KPIs in it. So we made progress in relation to a whole raft of the recommendations that have been made.
That's helpful. Tess?
Thank you. So risk register, and you've got a performance management framework in place. What about the training programme and the continuing professional development of staff? Is that in place as well?
Yes, extensive, yeah. So every staff member, as I mentioned, has their own individual action plan. So it's incumbent on all the management. They have, you know, we each have direct reports. So we're all aware of what that staff member's plan includes. This is what I need to do. Their training needs are discussed on the back of the activities that they need to engage in for the following year. And then we arrange training for them to ensure that they have the skills that they need. We've had an extensive amount of training, both internal and external, over the preceding 4 months. The induction of the new people was really comprehensive. So we built up a whole suite of materials that just wasn't in place previously in order to do that. We anticipate handling more cases about, for example, sexual harassment. So we got external training in from Rape Crisis Scotland so that staff understood how to engage appropriately with survivors, for example.
That's fine. Can I sure. just ask you also, yeah. Mr. Bruce, where do you actually get your HR support from for recruitment, for training and for induction support?
Sure. We do all that in-house. So, as I said, I've been engaged in public appointments, which is fundamentally about recruitment and selection since the office was established. I know that's to boards.
Sorry, what does it mean we do it in-house? Does it mean your team do it yourself, or do you get support from professionals?
No, we do it ourselves. Melanie Stronach, who I mentioned, she is an HR professional. You know, she's CIPD accredited, and I've got, probably about 30 years of experience in HR-related roles.
That's fine. So you've got somebody CIPD accredited.
Yes.
Thank you.
Sorry, can I just interrupt? Because I think Sue wanted to come in on one of Ian's answers. Sue.
Thank you, Convener. Yes, thank you very much, Mr. Bruce, for all those answers. We've heard a lot about the training and the induction, and you've reintroduced the review system. And you've also mentioned about recognising sexual harassment, engaging with survivors. But I suppose I'm trying to ask and ascertain, what systems have you put in place to allow members of your staff to feel confident about raising issues of concern about current working practices, governance, and maybe some issues that they're uncomfortable with? uncomfortable with within the working practice?
Yes, it is a good question. It's a very small office, and we've engaged. So I've said we do have monthly meetings with staff, so they're semi-formal, but that's all about the work of the organisation in general. We have SMT meetings, so the senior management team discuss how we're getting on as an organisation. Staff can contribute to the things that, you know, the senior management team should be talking about, and they can comment on any decisions or question any decisions that the senior management team make. Staff preferences are something that it's very important for us to take account of. So one of the things we did by way of team building was Myers-Briggs type indicators, and quite a lot of the staff in the office are introverts and don't like talking in public meetings about matters of concern.
You have to know that I'm a red.
Okay.
I'm a doer, and I like fun. So I suppose I'm probably trying to drill down on a bit more of a, sort of a safe face, a whistleblowing type thing.
Indeed.
You know, something that's not known, it's anonymous, you know, that sort of reporting internally for yourselves, because you've got quite a lot of change going on and there'll be a lot of upheaval. Yep. Perhaps.
Absolutely. So
just that secure place.
Yes. So staff can report concerns anonymously, but no staff have taken up that opportunity. Far and away, the majority of the staff, their preference is to have discussions with their line managers about issues that concern them. So that's what they've made clear to us. But we pretty much formally consult them on everything that concerns them, as well as things that don't, you know, wouldn't necessarily be obvious depending on the sort of organisation that you belong to, that you wouldn't necessarily think, well, that, you know, that doesn't really concern staff. But we are, you know, we engage them about every aspect of the organisation's work, including what happens at the senior level.
It's possible because it's a small team of 12, I think you said, so you get to know everybody quite well.
Indeed, We did bring out we did update the whistleblowing policy, and all staff were consulted on that in June. I think it's worth saying this about whistleblowing, and it's maybe not commonly understood. So it's quite a high bar to make a protected disclosure. For a staff member to make a protected disclosure, and that's quite a difficult thing in and of itself. You're talking about criminal activity or covering up criminal activity. So having a whistleblowing policy in place is all well and good, but by reference to the legislation, it's not sufficient. You need to have other reporting routes. And that's why we're quite keen to engage with the SPCB about the nature of our governance and where staff might go outside the organisation if they've got concerns. I think there needs to be a route there. And it doesn't necessarily have to be the, you know, that very high bar of criminal activity.
Thank you very much.
Thanks, Sue. Tess, come back to you.
Thank you, Mr. Bruce. Do you think now, at the moment, that your office is sufficiently resourced to do the run and maintain work that's required? Because there were some very serious picture painted in the annual report that was alarming. So how do you feel right now?
Unsure. And I'm being quite honest with you. As I've said, we've been taking stock throughout of how we're getting on, but there are so many variables. There's the backlog, there's the additional volumes, there's the additional complexity, but workforce planning is absolutely on our agenda for March and April, and all members of the senior management team know that that's something that they have to be engaging in now. So I'd mentioned Melanie had done some work on it already in respect of public appointments. I should say it's not as though she's not without support. The corporate services officer that we brought on board, she is largely dedicated to supporting public appointments at this point in time. So there is support in place there. Angela Glenn, the senior investigating officer, she meets her entire team at least once a week. So, you know, they have a case huddle, but they also discuss governance, how they're getting on, how quickly they're getting through the complaint volumes, They've also had discussions most recently about what the KPIs should be set at least, you know, for consultation. So workforce planning is part and parcel of the activity that's going on at the moment. So we'll draw all that information together. We'll take an initial view. We'll ask our stakeholders, how quickly do you think we should be getting through this stuff? And then we'll have, I think, a clearer picture of what our capacity should be to meet everyone's expectations.
Because the backlog alone will require a huge amount of person hours.
Yes. Yes. We've got more investigatory hours, so more capacity than the office has ever had in its history. But we are talking about quite a small team, so just even adding one additional investigating officer has added quite significantly, and they're all full-time. So under the prior commissioner, you had people on variable hours contracts. So, things have been changing. They're still changing, and we'll certainly look at all those different variables and come up with a plan and go to the SPCB, and we'll cut our coat according to our cloth and what the SPCB thinks about our proposals.
So not confident. I mean, I'm just conscious that in terms of resourcing, you've got things coming in by the day, then the backlog, small team, and then you say, well, how can we manage what we've got plus everything coming? So you need additional support.
It's perfectly possible that we will need additional resource. Equally, and you know, I mean, ultimately it'll be a decision for the SPCB to make, and it's for me to make a proper business case. We are talking about public money, and clearly we all need to bear that in mind. The office operated at a certain budget for a number of years, and as I've said, I think there were some historic concerns about how quickly we might have gotten through the work. So, but it has been and continues to be a changing picture in terms of what's coming into the office, and I think we all need to recognise that as well.
Thank you.
Yes, I think Colette just wants to...
Can I just quickly come in? Mr Bruce, thank you very much. And what it was when you touched upon the actual SPCB in terms of their input and support as well in terms of resources. I note from your biannual report that you've produced that it's to be confirmed in terms of contingent on SPCB agreement and funding. Since that report's been produced, has there been any movement there at all?
Yes. No, I do have to say the SPCB has been very supportive over this period. So, you know, they approved the business case that we made for the additional posts to be filled, and they subsequently approved the budget for the year, because obviously the annual report's historic. So our budget for the coming year's been approved. But as I say, we do have more workforce planning to do, and it may be that we need to go with the SPCB for some contingency funding in relation to the year ahead if we do go ahead with recruitment and that's approved. But clearly, you know, that will have longer term ramifications for our budget going forward.
No, thanks very much. That's been.
Thank you, Colette. Just with regard to the investigation manual, which you've talked about, which is in draft form and getting to that point where it's going to be shared, there was much discussion in both Deloitte's report and the other audit report about an external investigator, overseer, second opinion externally. And reading through it, it would appear to be my understanding that you would like the opportunity to internally review on the back of this handbook previous decisions made before moving to an external advisor or assistance. Is that right?
It's something that we have under consideration, so I'm not ruling anything out. I have to say that this for me is potentially one of the most problematic recommendations, which is why I've said, you know, really we need to discuss this with the SPCB. I think we need their agreement and some funding in order to take this forward. We already conducted an internal audit of all the statistical information that had been produced over the last couple of years. We needed to satisfy ourselves and everyone else, I think, for that matter, that we were reporting on a like-for-like basis. So we did do that. We provided the Standards Commission for Scotland with all of the decision letters that had been issued during the period in question, so they've had an opportunity to look at those. But I don't think the legislation anticipated us ever finding ourselves in a situation like this. So you're asking someone external to review the decisions of a commissioner when it was that commissioner's place to make those decisions. And some of those complaints and the investigations are historic, so you know that has an impact on what records are available, witness recollection, so on and so forth. There were no set procedures in place, which is why we have to have a manual, and the procedures that were in place were in flux. So what would an external person use in order to compare, you know, what was done against what perhaps should have been done over that period? And what happens with the results of an investigation of that nature? I have to say as well, so it has proven problematic for us, in as much as, yes, the recommendation's been made, the Section 22 report has said what it said, we have received quite a number of people who'd complained to the office previously, even going back to Bill Thompson's time, coming to us to say, I need my investigation reopened because the conclusion that was reached wasn't one that I was happy with. And far and away, the majority of those who are coming to us with those sorts of concerns, their complaints weren't even made during the period that the auditor has recommended should be looked at. And I suppose the final point on that is there's potentially a concern about precedent. So, you know, how many commissioners back does one go in order to, you know, have their homework marked, and by whom?
So it's not the case that you are saying absolutely no to an external advisor, whatever it's going to be called. However, in some sense, that's not the question that's immediately in front of you without this manual, and that there are other factors that need to play into that about the independence of the commissioner and the independence of the commissioner when those decisions were made, and the protections that are built in respect of councillors to the commission and in respect of MSP complaints to this committee, that there is a structure, and it's how that would interrelate with that structure and indeed the statutory requirements of the independence. Would that be fair?
Indeed. No, absolutely. As I say, I don't think any of the legislation ever anticipated a situation like this arising, and I'm not sure how the legislation would handle that sort of thing. It may be worth saying we have one precedent, but only to an extent, in as much as we'd had quite a significant complaint about the office, and I did commission someone to review that independently, but that was a complaint about us.
That wasn't a complaint about a councillor or an MSP, that was a complaint levied at the office.
It was, although ultimately, heading back, it connected to a complaint about a councillor. But, you know, as the person who conducted that review said, it's really not my place to determine whether or not, you know, the commissioner's decision was appropriate or not. And, the legislation just can't handle that.
Thank you. Colette, you want to...
Yeah, just in terms of the external independent review, can I ask, and it's maybe just your opinion, really, what do you think that the disposals that you give out in regards to the findings of a complaint are fit for purpose?
So perhaps I'm not understanding the question correctly, but might I rephrase or...?
Well, I suppose, for instance, the disposal of censure.
So we don't make recommendations about sanction at all. The role of our office is to determine really just whether or not the relevant code has or has not been complied with. And no, not at all.
Thank you, Colette. Tess, did you want to...
Thank you. Just on something, Mr. Bruce, that you last said, when there's a complaint against your office, who actually investigates that complaint?
So complaints about us and the normal run of things we have, and I've rewritten the procedure there as well, and it's now published, so there's a route of appeal to me, but they're handled by staff, and then it can be escalated and then eventually it would come to me for appeal. And in the event that an individual is still dissatisfied, they have recourse to the Scottish Public Services Ombudsman.
So you invest, you and your office investigate your own complaints against your office?
Yes, right. But we're required to do that. So
okay, and then it goes, to
the Scottish Public Services Ombudsman if people are unhappy.
Thank you.
A Complaints Standards Authority, which sits under the Ombudsman in Scotland, and the CSA has brought out basically a set of procedures for all public authorities to follow, and including ourselves. So that's what we follow.
Okay, thank you. In terms of, so the council complaints are not a matter for this committee. However, there is a key relationship between your office and the Standards Commissioner, and it appears to have broken down. So could you please share with this committee what work have you undertaken since taking office to restore this good working relationship, and what progress are you making? So I suppose it's the what did you start off doing to build the relationship, and then key milestones.
Sure. I got in touch with them straight away, frankly. I mean, you know, it's all of this stuff's about people, fundamentally. But no, I got in touch with their executive director straight away, and with the chair of the Standards Commission. So, you know, that was immediately on taking up post. We had a really productive chat about where we were and what we were going to do going forward. Key milestones, so we instituted almost immediately. So I now meet with the Standards Commission twice a year. So, you know, that's a formal meeting, and we discuss issues of mutual concern and interest. The staff are in regular contact with each other from both offices, and over and above that, so the whole investigatory team and me meet with the executive director and key members of her staff fortnightly, again, to have just, you know, a discussion about what we have in the pipeline, respectively, guidance. Additionally, we've worked alongside each other. So it's really all about, as I said, we sit as part of a bigger picture, and that's about the ethical standards framework in Scotland. And we all have, you know, distinct roles to play, but equally we want to support each other and other organisations to improve all of that. So we worked together as offices to assist the Scottish Government to revise the codes of conduct for councillors and board members. That was lots of work, but really worthwhile. Because, you know, we think the new codes that have come out, you know, I can make determinations, people understand what's expected of them. The Standards Commission's been able to produce guidance on the back of it. So we work together on all sorts of things, and I would describe it as an excellent relationship.
So you'd say the relationship's been mended?
It's an excellent relationship. But, I mean, you know, that's a commissioner marking his own homework. I'm sure, you know, they'd be best placed to provide you with an independent view.
Thank you very much, Tess. I'm now going to go to Bob.
Thank you, convener. There's a few questions I wanted to ask Mr. Bruce. It may be you've kind of partially answered some of them already in the course of your evidence, but I suppose it's an opportunity for you to put anything else on the record that you feel that is required. Clearly, reading the report and your comments, that there's been a lack of continuity with regard to responsibility for handling of MSP's complaints, and you refer to that within your statement within the annual report and your accounts. You've alluded to why that might be the case already, but it might be helpful if you just put on the record this morning why you think there has been such a lack of continuity.
So, a relatively small office with, you know, a set number of investigatory staff. We had a prior commissioner who I know had a relatively hands-on approach in respect of MSP complaint handling, although some of that was devolved within the office. That commissioner's clearly not in post. None of the staff who handled MSP complaints are in post, nor have they been in post for a while. So, you know, the commissioner who's currently on leave engaged with someone from the Northern Ireland Assembly to take that work on for a period. Ultimately, he had to go back to work for the Northern Irish Assembly when it was operating again. And I was asked to take the work on, which I did. That was meant to be a temporary measure. And I was to be replaced with a senior investigating officer who left the organisation, so that never happened. So basically I've been handling MSP complaints since I took them on while I was still the public appointments manager. So I think that is problematic in terms of continuity. It's a very complex area of regulation, for want of a better expression, for this office, and I've had to learn on the job. I've not done that alone. I've drawn on quite extensive legal advice and continue to do that to inform me. And clearly because it was problematic, well, I discussed this quite early on with our senior investigating officer, it had to be devolved. So she's been fully trained to take on responsibility for those complaints, as has the entire investigatory team. So everyone involved in investigations in the office now handles MSP complaints, and we have that continuity going forward, and they've all been provided with the same legal advice, and the investigations manual covers exactly what we need to do in relation to MSP complaints. I mentioned backlogs. It is an area in which we're doing fairly well. You know from the annual report that we have a major complaint that's still under investigation, so I can't discuss that. But in terms of everything new that's come into the office, I checked yesterday that the most aged complaint is from the 15th of December in respect of MSP complaint handling, so we're more or less up to date with those.
Can I check? Are you suggesting the issues with continuity existed with the previous team with the previous commissioner, and that those haven't been replicated with the new staff? Because I'm just, common sense can be a dangerous thing, Mr. Bruce, but we'll get to corporate memory in my next question in a second. But if you have people with experience in investigating complaints, even if there's maybe issues in how that is done consistently, and then you have a whole new set of people to investigate complaints who are new to the organisation, you might think there's more likely to be inconsistency, not less likely to be inconsistency. So I suppose when we're talking about a lack of continuity in investigating MSP complaints, we'll be talking historically under a previous set of staff. And can you say a little bit more about what you've done with this current team to make sure that there's a consistency and a continuity in how investigations take place?
Sure. So, under the commissioner who is currently off, we lost all investigatory staff. So everyone or anyone who may have handled MSP complaints left the organisation.
Yeah.
I took on responsibility for MSP complaint handling, and I've been doing that for 2 years now. Roughly.
Are you leading in every case now, Mr. Bruce? You're not delegating any of that?
No, absolutely. So the entire investigatory team that now works to me, who are, so they're not all new, so but two of them are, let's say, 2 years in post, and we've got the three others who are new, but all of those have been trained in MSP complaint handling by me.
Okay, so, and is that different from how it used to operate?
I did say loss of corporate memory has been an issue. So I had no involvement in MSP complaint handling under the prior commissioner at all. So I am not entirely clear how it was handled. I do know that he personally took part in MSP complaint handling, and I think it was devolved to possibly one other investigating officer, possibly two. But I
don't want to dwell on that for obvious reasons. I don't want to dwell on that. I suppose what I'm trying to do is look forward as much as look back. But as far as this committee would be concerned, is you have a team of, I think, five in total, I think you mentioned.
Yep.
And you would lead in all complaints, but you delegate the day-to-day operation of of dealing with the processes around those complaints and the details and the investigations to your team.
Yes.
And your role would be to make sure there's a continuity of process.
Yes. Yes. So
is that a reasonable...
Absolutely.
Way to
yes,
look
absolutely.
At it?
And the buck stops with me in terms of decisions. So as I said, we have an investigations manual. We've got a full set of procedures, which also covers MSP complaint handling. So I'll try to give you an example. There are a set of tests that need to be met in the legislation in order for investigations to proceed. So we have an assessment form, and every staff member who takes on a new MSP complaint needs to go through each part of that form and to provide reasons for their decision-making in relation to whether or not a complaint should proceed. That then comes to me, and I ultimately make the final decision on whether or not their judgment has been appropriate and what should then happen with that complaint. So it is delegated, it will continue to be, but I make the ultimate decisions.
And just for clarity, that investigations manual, is that a manual that's been in operation for some time, or is that a new manual?
It's new, so we're now at version 4. As the auditors recognised, we didn't have something formal in place that was being operated, so our senior investigating officer had to basically populate all of that. It's not as though we had nothing in place, so it's fair to say that the prior commissioner did have a manual, but it wasn't being operated, so some of the material from that has been brought forward, and some of that did relate to MSP complaint handling.
Right. Thanks, Mr. Bruce. I just want you to put that on the record so that there's a completeness of evidence this morning. Now, I was going to ask about workforce planning. I think you've probably covered that, but I'm going to just ask it anyway, just in case there's any gaps that you want to fill in. So could you maybe say a little bit more about what workforce planning you are undertaking to address the high staff turnover? And you mentioned the lack of corporate memory. I suppose it's about stabilising and it's about recovery, and you've kind of said a lot about that. But the key thing is, what about resilience? Like any organisations, it just takes one or two people to not be there, and there's a significant challenge. So you've mentioned workforce planning, but can you maybe link that to future resilience?
Yeah, no, you're absolutely right, and it's particularly challenging in an organisation of this size. But I have made it clear to every section that I want people to circulate around. So, for example, the investigating officers, I need at least one or two of them to become familiar with public appointments work. We always had fail-safes in the office. I've mentioned Melanie, but, you know, it's a bit of a joke in the office, but, you know, we often spoke about what happens if such and such goes under a bus and what do we have in place for that person to be covered. So I do understand and I agree with and accept your point that we do need to ensure that we've got cover for all the different sections of the office, including fail-safes, and our workforce planning will include that.
Okay, I think MSPs, that would chime with us, where we employ staff for one thing, but in reality, the demands of the office means you deploy them as you need them for your business needs, and I think staffers would recognise that as well.
Yep.
Moving on, your auditor found that based on legal advice you obtained, the operation of the investigation process is amended in August 2020, and in particular the assessment process did not comply with the required legislation. What confidence do you have that the MSP complaints handled during this period were assessed properly? So you've spoken a lot about getting that continuity, getting that consistency going forward, but if we just have a slight look back, what confidence do you have that investigations were assessed appropriately?
Sure. Well, at the time in question, I was assessing them. So inevitably, I'm going to say to you, I have considerable confidence. But notwithstanding that, and I think it's fair to say this, you know, I wasn't trained in MSP complaint handling. I had to learn on the job. I was quite clear with the commissioner at the time, look, if I don't know something here, we need legal advice on it, and I would say that the legal advice you're referring to didn't concern MSP complaint handling. I hope that gives you some assurance. It absolutely was about handling of complaints for councillors and board members.
I'm not really sure how to interrogate the wrong word, Mr. President, looking at it that way, but I'm not sure how to probe further in relation to that? Because, of course, you would give that reassurance. And I think you've put the record today where whenever you thought there was a lack of clarity or you weren't sure, you sought external legal advice as you went along. I suppose there's a degree of reassurance there. And, Convener, I think some of my colleagues want to expand on this point further. So rather than me hogging this whole line of questioning, I would anticipate, Mr. Bruce, there may be some further questions in this area. Convener.
Very kind, Deputy Convener. Just before I hand over to Colette, really, I'm going to state the obvious, but I think it needs to be stated. When you were talking about devolving the investigations with regard to MSPs to your staff, you were talking about devolving the process, the actual decision on whether or not there is or is not a breach rests with you in your role as acting commissioner, but as an independent commissioner. And those final decisions are, of course, always taken by you,
yes,
based on all of the evidence that's presented to you following the investigation. That would be right, wouldn't
no it? No question. And we have an audit trail for all the decisions that I make in the office. Yeah.
I'm very grateful for that. Colette.
Yeah, thanks very much, Convener. And just following on from some of the questioning that our co-convener submitted, can I just ask about the MSP complaints that were dismissed as inadmissible during the relevant period and that were subject to, you know, external re-examination? And, you know, will they be, you know, looked at again? And if so, what progress, really?
Sure. So, no. The recommendation relates directly to the directions that were issued by the Standards Commission for Scotland, and that relates to complaints about board members and councillors. So the recommendation doesn't relate to reinvestigating MSP complaints. The auditors didn't raise any concerns about that.
So I take then that the door is firmly closed on that aspect of it then?
We haven't had a recommendation in that area. I mean, I suppose if the committee feels that those investigations should be independently re-examined, it would be open to the committee to issue directions to make that effect, I would guess.
I suppose my concern really would be that if it was, you know, the similar complaints that came forward and we're basically dropping the ball in that aspect of it, and there is a huge issue on a certain, you know, area, then it's maybe something. I don't know if you've got a feel for if that was something that was, you know, that was coming through strong there.
I think we're getting into quite tricky territory here because we're talking about judgment, and I mentioned a commissioner marking their own homework earlier. So you're asking me basically for a view on whether or not ultimately the recommendations I was making to the commissioner at that point in time should be re-examined. Clearly I'm going to say I don't think so, because I was doing my best to make the appropriate recommendations in terms of assessment at that time. But ultimately, yes, you know, the decisions about whether to proceed and how to proceed were the commissioner's. And so there's been a recommendation in relation to councillor and member complaints and whether they should be reinvestigated. So I suppose the answer, if I'm going to shorten it, would be for the committee to take a view on whether or not it feels that assurance in that area would be helpful.
Might it help, Colette, to say that the position became apparent because of questions that were being asked by our equivalents in relation to councillor cases that came to them. The previous committee in the previous session, as far as you're aware, never raised those questions with the commissioner in relation to MSP complaints.
No.
That's helpful.
Okay, thank you. Sorry, can I just ask as well, really, and you have touched upon it, but just to seek further clarity, is what progress has been made with the backlog of MSP complaints, which you referred to in your statement, and that's prefacing your annual report and accounts as well?
Sure. So there's the very large complaint, the super complaint, we call it in the office, so, and I can't talk about it, but, you know, the numbers are there. So that is still under investigation, and it's very complex, and there are an awful lot of moving parts. But if we set that aside, and we have had quite a few MSP complaints in this financial year, additional ones, so again, the trend there does look to be that, that those are on the rise. We have worked our way through all of those up to 15th December, so basically, you know, there's no backlog in relation to those.
Right, OK. And just finally, the annual report and the accounts actually show a very steep rise in the volume of complaints received against MSPs. How is the office coping with, you know, obviously the workload in terms of that? And how confident are you they will be investigated fully, sort of in line with your statutory obligations?
Yes. So the super complaint, I think, is the main one, and all staff are working on that at the moment, and we've also, you know, as well as everything else, so we have regular meetings to discuss what progress we're making there, but, yeah, I think if I go into detail, then perhaps we're in difficult territory. I am not sure how long it will take us to complete that investigation, and how much additional resource that we will need. So clearly that's part of our workforce planning as well. How does one put this? I am not sure that that represents what's going to look like regular business for us. Okay. I think that's, let's call it, a relatively rare event. So in general, the trend is an increase in MSP complaints, but, you know, not an astronomical one. It just so happens that super complaint has posed particular challenges for us at a time perhaps when we may not have wished for them, but I absolutely understand my responsibilities, as do all the staff, and we do intend to investigate that fully, as well as everything else that comes into the office. You know, we don't set things aside because we're busy. That just wouldn't be right.
Okay. Well, hopefully going forward, that super complaint, there's lessons learned and negates the need for the volume and concentration of staff in that aspect.
Indeed.
So, no, thank you very much.
Thank you, Colette. Bob, I think you had a follow-up question.
Yes. Sorry to get hung up on the process, Mr. Bruce. I suppose so we know that you lead in all MSP complaints, but you delegate the day-to-day investigation responsibilities to one of a team of five. They're all fully trained in a new and refreshed investigations manual, and they're encouraged to talk to each other and draw on each other's support. So we've got all that. So when you then get that final report on your desk from the investigating officer, it will make a recommendation about whether the complaint has, well, clearly almost it'll be admissible at that point because it's got to that extent, and the recommendations within it, and the working has shown that they will lay out that evidence. And you, as commissioner, have to decide whether you are going to agree, ratify, sanction this as the way forward, or to change the ultimate decision been made. Now where you agree with your investigating officer and that moves forward in the process, fine. But there must be situations where you won't agree with the recommendation made by your investigating officer, and that's okay, that's an important check and balance in the system. But when you don't agree with those recommendations, what is the process in terms of supporting your investigating officer to, if you like, continuous professional development or review of the case? Do at that point, what happens? So is there a supportive learning experience for your investigating officer? Or I suppose what happens? And separate from that, do you, I'm not asking for the number, but do you keep track of the amount of times where you agree with the conclusion of your investigating officer and where you don't agree? Because obviously any commissioner, not just yourself in your acting commissioner's role, if there's an increasing number of situations where you don't agree with the conclusion of your investigating officer, that might point to issues or weaknesses or challenges within the investigating process to begin with. So what I thought was going to be a pretty straightforward question might be a little bit more complicated now, but I think it would be helpful for the committee to know.
Sure. I'm very happy to talk to you about the operation of the office. So let's start with the first part of your question. Yes, so there's a formal process in place, and as much as a written report recommendations comes to me and, do you agree, do you disagree? So all the investigatory team handle all the different types of complaints. You know, they work through them, and I get a report every week in the form of an email. So I have a summary of all the different cases. Some of those involve MSP complaints, so we'll talk about those. So I provide my written response in relation to their report, any draft letters they've prepared, and then in the email. So that's all done on a sort of formal basis in writing. As I've said, we've got an audit trail. Where I feel that I need to discuss a given report, where I may disagree with some of the conclusions. So we have various options for doing that. Sometimes if I think it's a team learning thing, I'd mentioned that, so Angela and the team, the senior investigating officer on the team, they have a meeting at least once a week. So I will join them for that meeting, and we will go through all of those cases, and we will collectively have a discussion about where I might have disagreed with a particular decision that's been taken. And we would go through my reasoning. But it's not just, so the buck stops with me. I get that, but equally, I'm not infallible. So we would have a proper grown-up discussion about why I've reached my conclusion, and I would ask them, why have you reached your conclusion? And we'll come to a settled view together, collectively, on what the appropriate response is. We need to learn as an organisation, and, very often, every day is a school day for us, very often you get things in that you've just never seen before. None of us have ever seen before, and we need to take a view by comparing that with the applicable legislation. So that's the way that we operate. If I think it's something for the individual for us to discuss together, I will discuss it with the individual, sometimes involving the senior investigating officer, sometimes not. Am I tracking whether or not I disagree with people's decisions? So not formally, but clearly, I'll have a view myself about how people are getting on. I have every confidence in the people that we've recruited. It was a good recruitment process. So I know for a fact that they had the skills that they required. But remember, they're just coming to the end of their probationary period. All of this is relatively new to them. And I don't think it would be fair to me for me to start reaching conclusions about who's good and who's not at this point in time. What I can say is, in my opinion, their judgment, all of them, their judgment seems pretty sound to me.
Maybe just, convener, I think this is quite important, Mr. Bruce, because your team will be watching this evidence session and exchange. Of course they would be. I would be, if I was a member of your team, absolutely, probably watching it right now. Get back to your work if you are watching it right now, watch it later. But what I would say is I wasn't casting aspersions on your team. It was just more about checks and balances in the system, and if the data was to flag up something that needs to be attended to, perhaps it was a lack of clarity in the investigations manual, or just a lack of clarity in processes more generally. So, for staff that are watching this, I think it's important, to say there's no aspersions on them. It's more about trying to look at checks and balances in the system and the processes that underpin it. And I think what you're saying, Mr. Bruce, is it's not a case of the investigating officer goes away for 3 months and comes back with a conclusion on your desk. There's a weekly review process and an ongoing basis. So no one's going to go off on a tangential path in the investigation that you're unaware of. That's a more of a collegiate approach to the investigations, if I've captured that properly, Mr. Bruce. Oh,
very much so. Very much so. I'll go beyond that. So we are learning as an organisation, and we are adapting our procedures all of the time. And that's in response to issues that come to us. I'll give you one simple example. So, those team meetings, it's not just to review cases. If something comes up and we think we can do something better for the public here, we change the way in which we operate. You know, the tone of all of our communications has changed since I came into post, but we are constantly updating our letters to meet what we think are the needs of the public. Someone came to us recently and they'd made a complaint and it wasn't upheld, but they came back and said, I don't think I've been treated fairly because, you know, I don't think you looked at all of the bits of the code potentially that you might have. I'm paraphrasing a wee bit. So we always do. We don't expect members of the public to know what's in the code and what's applicable to conduct and what isn't. But because they'd raised that concern, we'd had a chat with them. We together as a team concluded, look, we could make it clear in the letters. We can just say, even though you didn't say which part of the code it was that you were complaining had been breached, can we assure you we've looked at the whole code in relation to that conduct in order to reach a decision, and that's why these are the bits of the code that are applicable. So all our letters say that now. That's the way we operate.
Yes, thanks, Mr. Vice Convener. I had a couple of unrelated questions, but I don't know if you want me to do those just now or not.
No, please. Please move on. Thanks, Bob.
Okay, thank you. Okay, so the last couple of questions from myself really, I suppose, is COVID-related and the necessity need for change in working practices. Obviously, you want to know what the satisfaction has been with the appointment rounds on the part of the panel and body chairs maintained during the new ways of working during the pandemic. So obviously, your office is very heavily involved in those appointments. The process has had to be tweaked because of the pandemic. What has the satisfaction been on of the panel and body chairs that have been had to engage in that appointments process? What's their views on how it's been handled been?
I think it's been handled relatively well, although kind of inevitable. I suppose all organisations had to be agile during that period, and it did take the government a wee while to put things in place that they hadn't anticipated they were going to need. I mean, we were quite fortunate in as much as we'd established teams and all that side of things just because that was in the run of our work as an organisation. So all that was in place before the pandemic hit, and it wasn't all in place with the Scottish Government. So it was an incremental process. But I think they've done relatively well, and people have been relatively happy about what's been put in place. So, I mean, you know, interviews being conducted remotely and so on and so forth. And I anticipate we're probably looking at a hybrid model going forward. But generally, I'm quite positive about public appointments and the way things have gone. And my more recent discussions with the Scottish Government have been very productive, I have to say. And I'm quite hopeful about the future.
OK, thank you. I won't explore that further, but thank you for putting that on the record. And the final question for myself is that your annual report and accounts refer to planned activity which was suspended or postponed due to prioritisation of other work, understandably so. Can you explain more about what work was delayed and when you would envisage that those delays will be addressed? So some unavoidable delay, I would imagine, but can you say a little bit more about where those delays have been and when you think the office will be able to catch up on that?
Sure. I think we've more or less caught up. I mean, certainly we've continued to fulfil the statutory function. So that is about our providing oversight using public appointments advisors of appointment rounds. So that has continued unabated. We'd anticipated perhaps running some audits, but they weren't essential. But, you know, it's just helpful to do that health check separately to the direct oversight that you provide. This year, I've decided to drop. We usually do a collated report of applicant surveys, so we haven't stopped running those. We're still running them on a round-by-round basis, and we're still feeding the results of those into the system, but we won't have a collated annual report of applicant views this year, simply because we don't have the capacity to do it. And we'd stopped surveying panel chairs and body chairs for a period. So the period in the annual report about their views on the process and on the contribution of the advisor, all of that's been reinstated. So we do have other activities in our business plan. And as I've said, I think potentially we're going to need more resource in the public appointments function and clearly an unfilled vacancy. And we need to sort that out if we're going to fulfil all our ambitions in that area. code of practice has been slightly delayed, but I expect to have that with government either today or at some point next week for a very final consultation. I think we've more or less agreed everything that we need to there, so I'm not concerned, and I don't think the committee should be.
I've got no further questions, because I just thank Mr. Bruce for his evidence in answering those questions this morning. Thank you, Convener. Thank you, Mr. Bruce.
Thank you very much indeed, Bob. Perhaps you'd be glad to know, I think we're coming to the end, but what I did want to pick up on possibly as a final question or statement from your report was indeed the very final paragraph that you put, where I'm going to quote this to put it on record. I end by expressing my gratitude to the members of the senior management team and to every staff member in the office. They have shown remarkable resilience and commitment to our work during an exceptionally challenging period. I'm immensely proud to belong to such a dedicated team of people and grateful for both their positive attitude and their efforts. I think we've certainly heard today and from your report that there were challenging times in the past. But Ian, can I thank you for coming today? Can I thank you for your full and frank answers to our questions? And I wish you, and possibly more importantly, your team, all the very best going forward. So thank you. I would now like to close the public part of this meeting, and the committee will move into private.